بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم وبارك على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا وإمامنا محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد. Before we continue, we humbly, kindly ask all those who don't wish to participate in the session to either remain silent or leave the musalla. We humbly, kindly ask you that. If you don't want to listen to the class or participate, that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. It's not mandatory. But if you sit in the musalla, we ask that you respect the ilm that's being presented. Inshallah, jazakumullahu khairan. Allah bless you all. Ameen. Last night, before we move forward with tonight's lesson, or tonight's session, we mentioned many things, many benefits, and many points of interest for those who have a taste for this science. And that is, or as is the way of the people of Hadith, from the early generations up to this day, is making review of knowledge is a means of keeping that knowledge alive. As some of the pious predecessors used to say, مُذَاكَرَةُ الْعِلْمِ حَيَاتُهُ. It said, reviewing and revising ilm is the lifeblood of ilm. That's how knowledge survives and continues and is passed down from generation to generation. And that's how you find someone, a scholar or a student, a muhaddith or a faqih. You ever sit down and ask yourself, how does he know so much? How is he able to give 100 fatwa in one sitting without stuttering, without thinking twice? How can he quote here, quote there, quote there, so on and so forth? And one of the reasons behind that is that he's constantly living in that ilm. He's reviewing that knowledge. You come and you see the finished product. You see him sitting in a circle, ya shaykh, alayjuz, alayjuz, etc. And he gives you the answer. Or the Qari of the Quran Kareem. He recites without looking from his heart. You get the final product. It looks easy and simple for you. But you don't see the long, countless hours of hard work of review and revision. With his students, with his teachers, with his colleagues, writing, speaking, people call him all day, every day. He or she is busy with ilm, with reviewing knowledge. So therefore, whenever you find it difficult to keep all of the information, whenever you find it hard to have memory of what you previously took before you keep forgetting, there are many reasons behind it. But from the biggest of them is that you're not making enough review. And we mentioned in our work, 40 Hadith from Seeking Knowledge, the Hadith of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, when he spoke to people, when he gave them the greetings, he would give the greetings 3 times so he would be heard. And when he said a kalima, he would repeat that kalima 3 times. The hadith says, hatta tufhama anhu, until that word or that statement or whatever he was giving to the Sahaba was understood. And we put this hadith under the chapter heading, repetition is the key to understanding. Repetition is the key to memorizing. So if you want the knowledge to stay put, to stay in one place, you must constantly review and revise. So therefore, before we move on tonight, be the subhanahu wa ta'ala, as is our sunnah, who can remind us of some of the things that we mentioned last night in brief, 5 minutes, inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who can remind us what we took last night, one benefit that we mentioned last night. Fadl farah. Bismillah. One thing, one benefit. Coach, last night, yeah. Anything that you learned that we mentioned yesterday, follow. That a condition for a companion is that he or she had to have physically met the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam. Khair, very good. Moving on.
So the second condition is that you believed in it.
That the, at the time of meeting the Prophet, he or she had to be a mu'min or a mu'mina, and not later on. Those who met the Prophet as mushrikeen, as kuffar, as Christians, as Jews, and then they accepted the sunnah later on, are not from the Sahaba. Good. Next point, follow up.
They had to die as a Muslim.
They had to die as a Muslim. If they left Islam, wa'iyadu billah, and died upon that, they are not considered to be from the Sahaba, if they apostated and then came back to Islam before death, they are considered to be from the Sahaba. Very good. Come on, quickly. So quick exercise. I'm still waiting for them. Still waiting. I'm not going to leave you alone.
Learning about the Sahaba softens and melts your heart.
Learning about the Sahaba softens and melts one's heart. If you have a hard heart, if you feel that your heart is blackened and rusty, and you have sins, you have stress and worries, and you have things other than Allah in your heart, then from the ways of curing yourself is to read about the Sahaba, how they live. Very good. Next point. Any points from the sisters? Any other points? Yalla, it's reviewed. It's follow.
In order to learn about
that. Nah, you can't look. You can't look. From the heart. From the heart.
In order to learn about the Prophet
Seerah, it is a condition in learning the Seerah Nabawiyyah that you have learned the Seerah of the Sahaba. One is a bridge to the next. You cannot understand Seerah to the Nabi unless you read about the Seerah of the Sahaba. Very good. Moving on. Next point. Fadl.
When you have a great understanding of the other sciences, you have to learn about the Sahaba.
In order to have a thorough, proper understanding of the other sciences, you have to have some background on the Sahaba. And we forgot to mention actual fiqh. We mentioned usul al-fiqh last night, but actually fiqh too. And the usul of fiqh is the fiqh of the Sahaba. Very good. Next point, moving on. Anything else? You have to make review. Hold on.
We mentioned how Aisha radiallahu anha said, in your gatherings, you should keep mentioning the Sahaba, especially Umar.
That she said, Zayinu majalisakum bi dhikri Umar. Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, perfume and adorn and beautify your circles and gatherings by speaking good of Umar radiallahu anha. Ascent. We said that it's a benefit of talking about the Sahaba. It's a means of bringing life and joy and barakah to the majlis of ilm. Ascent. Any other benefits before we move on? We talked about the word Sahaba. What does it mean in the Arabic language? Where does it come from? What does it derive from? What is the singular word for Sahaba? You said Sahabi or Sahib. I said, any other benefits before we move on? That's all we spoke about for a whole hour. That's the only thing we benefited.
We also mentioned how if a person becomes a Sahabi and apostates from the deen, and comes back to it, the majority of ulama says that he is still a Sahabi.
Khair, Ahsant. Very good. Any other benefits for more brothers and sisters? Khair, inshallah. Let's get started with tonight's lesson. We have briefly, the author he says, Muqaddimatun fi al bayt. الصواب أن آل أو آل بيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وصف يجمع ثلاثة أوصاف ذريته وأزواجه وبني هاشم الذين هم بني علي وبن جعفر وبن العباس وبن عقيل وبن الحارث بن عبد المطلب هناك خلاف في بني أبي لهب الذين أسلموا والتحقيق أنهم داخلون في أهل البيت ذرية النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم له سبعة من الأبناء ثلاثة من الذكور هم القاسم وعبد الله إبراهيم وأربعة من الإناث هم رقية وأم كلثوم وزينب وفاطمة وهي الوحيدة التي the author then says the next point is an introduction towards Ahlul Bayt or Ahlul Bayt, a very crucial and important concept of studying the companions from so many different aspects. Before they differed and disagreed, before there were war, or there was war and turmoil, but just to know who is considered Ahlul Bayt. Who are Ahlul Bayt? Because they have special rights over us. They have special rights. Not only are they Sahaba, but they are related to the Prophet ﷺ, so they have a higher right, a stronger right upon us all. So therefore, this pertains to the sciences of Hadith, and most importantly to the actual way and the creed of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. The author, he says, the correct view, the strongest view, is that Ahlul Bayt is a comprehensive term that includes three types or classes of people, three categories of people. The first are his children, the children of the Prophet ﷺ. Number one, his children. Number two, his wives. And number three, the offspring of Hashim. The progeny of Hashim. And they are the children of Ali, the children of Ja'far, and the children of Al-Abbas, and also the children of Aqil and Al-Hadith ibn Abdul Muttalib. All of these people are included in Ahlul Bayt, according to the author. He then says, and there are some differences of opinion with regards to the offspring or the children of Abu Lahab, those who accepted Islam. He then goes on to mention the children of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And he says that the Prophet had how many children?
Seven.
How many boys? Huh? How many girls? The boys are?
Abdullah,
Qasim, Ibrahim, Asad. The girls?
Fatima.
Uqayya. Kulthum.
Zainab.
Asad. Khayran, inshallah. And then he goes on to mention a few more points with regards to most of them coming from Khadija, with exceptions to Ibrahim, whereas she was from Maria, radiallahu ta'ala anha. The author then says, Zawjatuhu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, umhatul mu'mineen, wa dalilu ala annahunna min ahli bayti, qawlu ta'ala ya nisa' an-nabi, yasunnaka ahli min an-nisa', in taqaytunna fala takhtara min thuni, fayatma alladhi fi qalbihi marad, wa qulna qawlan ma'rufa. وقلنا في بيوتكن ولا تبرجن تبرج الجاهلية الأولى وأقمنا الصلاة وآتينا الزكاة وأطعنا الله ورسوله إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم رجس أهل البيت ويطهركم تطهيرا والمراد بأزواجه هم الذين ثبت دخول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بهن وزواجه بهن ووصفهن بأمهات المؤمنين واللاتي ثبت زواجه بهن صلى الله عليه وسلم 11 وتوفي في حياته صلى الله عليه وسلم منهم اثنتان هما زين بنت الحارث الهلالية وخديجة بنت الخويلد وتوفي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن 9 منهن جمعنا في القول العظمي توفي رسول الله عن 9 نسوة إليهن تعزى المكرمات وتنسب فعائشة ميمونة فصفية وحفصة تتلوهن هند وزينب جويلية مع رمة ثم سودة 63 نظمهن مهذب. The author then says, and please excuse me for me reading in a very fast, rushed pace, but we're very short on time, and I want to give you as much information as possible. Inshallah, you can forgive me for that. The author says, the wives of the Prophet are the mothers of the believers. They are the mothers of the believers. And he quotes several verses from the 33rd chapter of the Quran al-Kareem, Surah Al-Ahzab, in which Allah the Exalted says that Allah only wishes to purify you, O Ahlul Bayt. Allah wishes to remove filth from you, O Ahlul Bayt, and cleanse you in a thorough manner. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He called these people Ahlul Bayt, and He said in the previous verse that they were Nisa al-Nabi, women of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that is the proof that all of his wives are considered to be from Ahlul Bayt. So those who say otherwise, that the Prophet's wives were not Ahlul Bayt, they are not upon the manhaj of the Qur'an al-Kareem. The author then says, and was meant by the wives of the Prophet are the women that he married, in which he lived with them, and the marriage was consummated. And the Prophet والسلام, he married 11 women. And when he died, he had 9 wives. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Two of them passed away during his lifetime. And they were Zainab, the daughter of Al-Harith al-Hilaliyah, and Khadija bint Khuwaylid, radiallahu ta'ala anhunna. He then quotes 3 lines of poetry in which all 9 wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam upon which he died are mentioned. He says, Tuwafiya Rasulullahi an tis'i niswatin. The Messenger of Allah died with 9 wives. إِلَيْهِنَّ تُعْزَى الْمُكْرَمَاتُ وَتُنْسَبُ. He says, all nobility is attributed to those women. فَعَيْشَةُ, number 1. مَيْمُونَةُ, number 2. فَصَفِيَّةُ, 3. حَفْصَةُ, تَتْلُوهُنَّ, هِنْدٌ, وَزَيْنَبُ, a 7. He then mentions Juwayriya and Ramla, and he also goes on to mention Sauda. خَيْرٌ, إِنْشَاءَ اللَّهُ. Then the author, he goes on to speak about the creed of Ahl-Sunnah wal Jama'ah with regards to the Sahaba. What do we believe about these people? What do we say about them? What position and what stance do we take with regards to the wives, children, companions, and disciples of the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam? And that's what we will stop here with regards to this and move on to what's in the book, the 10 Promised Jannah. And as we said last night, and we will say again, is that these introductions are very important. Before you get into studying the lives of the Khulafa Rashideen, before you get into studying the lives of the other six companions who were promised Jannah altogether, before you get into the lives, the narrations of these seven companions that were promised paradise, but you must have these usul, these foundations. Inshallah, we won't spend any more time on that. The first of the 10 companions who were promised paradise all at once, all together. And I continue to say that because there were many other companions that were promised paradise. First and foremost, all of the companions of the Rasul alayhi salam were promised paradise, all of them. When Allah the Sublime the Exalted, He sent down the legislation for fighting in His cause, making jihad in His cause. And He said, those who go out and fight, they spend their lives, they spend their wealth, they're not equal to those who remain home, those who sit at home. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla, He expounded upon this, those who have excuses, those who don't have excuses, those who are blind, those who are lame, those who lack the physical strength to go out and fight. And He concluded these verses by saying, وَكُلَّ وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْحُسْنَى. And Allah, He says, وَكُلَّن يعني كل واحد من الصحابة. Allah has promised every companion al-husna. And what's meant by al-husna is Jannah, is paradise. So this verse in the Quran al-Kareem from Surah An-Nisa clearly affirms that all of the companions were promised Jannah. And as Ibn Hazm rahimahullah, he mentioned that there's ijma', there is scholarly consensus that all of the Sahaba are in Jannah, they're all in paradise. So that's general. As far as the specific promise of Jannah, then the Prophet ﷺ, he promised these 10 companions Jannah in one narration. There's more than one version of this narration, but what's meant here is that he mentioned them all together. That does not mean that there are other companions that weren't promised paradise. La. Rather, the Messenger of Allah ﷺ, he spoke to and he spoke about several men and women, and he told them that they will be in Jannah. Such as who?
The man that came to the Masjid, the wudu. The wudu, water was dripping from his face, from his beard, and then the Prophet said, a man will enter upon you, and he is among the paradise people.
Tayyip, another example, something more famous.
Bilal
radiallahu anhu. What did he say to Bilal?
Hear your footsteps.
He said, footsteps? Or he said something else? Khair, Mashi, anything else?
Khair,
what does that mean in English?
Family,
yes. What else?
Okasha,
Tayyip, who else?
Khoban.
Tayyip, Khair, inshallah. Al-Muhim is that the Prophet ﷺ promised several companions, Jannah specifically, but what we're dealing with here are those who are known as who? Or what? Al-Ashara Al-Mubashirun Al-Kasra, right? Al-Fatah. Many people, they say that. Mubashirun, that's a khabar, fahish. It's not a simple, small mistake. That they were Mubashirun. They were giving the Bushra of Jannah. Khayr, inshallah, let's move on because we're running low on time. Who's our designated reader tonight from the brothers or from the sisters? Who's our volunteer, inshallah? Anybody? Mubarak didn't want to read for me, Allah Mustaan. Nobody likes me tonight. No one wants to read for me, Allah Mustaan. What's the reason, Ibrahim? What did I do? Allah Mustaan. Nah, he doesn't want to volunteer. Nah. Tafadda, Bismillah.
He is Abdullah ibn Uthman ibn Abi Qufafa.
Qufafa.
What?
Huhafa.
And some say his name was Atiyah, the greatest Siddiq.
You want a microphone, perhaps? You have a microphone for him?
Follow.
Fatak Mubarak, خلاص. That's not what I do.
And some say his name was Atiyah, the greatest Siddiq and Khalifa of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was born approximately 2 years before the year of the elephant. He accompanied the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before Islam and was from the foremost to embrace and accept it. He remained in the company of the Holy Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until he passed on.
Right. In other words, it's going to come in the lessons on the Sahaba. The introduction is that the best of the best, the cream of the crop of the Sahaba, is Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. He is the best of the best. And after Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu is Umar al-Faruq. So Abu Bakr Siddiq is the Sheikh of the Sahaba. The most knowledgeable, the most learned, the most virtuous, the best of the best. And that's why we begin with him. Obviously, we don't have that much time to expound on his life in detail. And some of these points, these are called bullet points or bulletin points. The main, Rusul Aqlam, the main highlighting points with regards to his name, his lineage, when he was born, and his background. And this is a must that we say this, is that whenever you want to read about someone, in English or Arabic, there are certain facts that are standard and that are mandatory. And there are other things which are benefits on the side. In other words, we have certain pieces of information, la budda minha. It's binding. A person's name, his kunya, his lineage, his nisba. Who was he ascribed to? What tribe, what profession, what clan, what did he do for a living, etc. When was he born? Very important. Because how a person, or when a person was born, where he was born, how he was raised, how he grew up is vital to his upbringing and the cultural environment, the political environment, the religious environment, and all of these things led to him being a Siddiq. Just as how the Prophet was born, how he was raised, how he grew up, that all led to him being Rasul. And this is crucial in studying the seerah. Why was the Prophet sent from Mecca? Why was he not sent from another place, another town, another people? Why did he come in the year that he came? There are reasons why. So when you study the seerah, or when you read anybody's background, biography, it is not important, it's a crucial, vital catalyst that you understand how they lived, where did they grow up, what was the movement at that time, what were the problems at that time. A person's economic background has a big effect on how they grow up and what they do. Revolutions were started, countries were toppled, and empires fell and crumbled because of money, because of religion, the change of power is vital for us to understand these points. Everybody got this at your all? So we said, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, his name is Abdullah. Abu Bakr was his what? His kunya. Okay, but his name was Abdullah, the son of Uthman, who was the son of Abu Quhafa. And some say, in other words, there's differences of opinion on what his actual name was. Some of his say his name was Atiq, and others say that was another nickname that he had. And we summed up all of his virtues by saying he is the greatest Siddiq, a Siddiq al-Akbar, for his truthfulness, for his faith, for his instant embracing of faith and of Islam, and believing in the Prophet when all odds were against him. And he's also the Khalifa of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His leader, his deputy, the one who was in charge, the one who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam allowed to be the spiritual, political leader of the Muslims. We then said he was born approximately 2 years before the year of the elephant. In other words, the Arabs, they didn't have what we have today of modern means of calculation of time and chronology, things like this. Chronological order. Rather, they memorize things by the events. The year of the elephant, the year of this, the year of this conquest, the year of this battle, the year of this unity, this federation, etc. as many other people did. As many other people did. My fiance said, the ear of the black rat, the ear of the donkey, the ear of the horse. This is normal. And many other cultures. Abraham, the ear of the elephant was in what ear? In the common era. We're in Minnesota. So we say, this is the common era, is the Viking calendar. Scandinavian calendar, the common era. What year was that in? Anybody know? When was the year of the elephant? 571 of the common era, of the Viking calendar. 571, anybody else? Khair and inshallah. Why was it called the year of the elephant?
570.
Why was it called the year of the elephant? Huh? Well, who was Abraha? He's from Yemen? Or Somalia? Maybe. Mumkin. Salah. Possibly. It's a big possibility. Allah. Ethiopia, Eritrea, Djibouti, Somalia back then. So, exactly. Perhaps it was Somalia. Allah. I don't know. Is that what was his story of Juan? Nah, Farah. What was the story? What happened? What was the year of the elephant? Quickly, we ran out of time after the law. Allah Allah, I'm tired. Mulabas. Mubarak. Afidhum. Tayyib, anybody else? What was the year of the elephant? You're too far away. I need to come close, close, close. I want to see you, I want to feel you. I want to be. Ta'ala, fadl. Come close. Yeah. I feel your positive energy. Don't worry. Inshallah. We haven't had one answer from the sisters yet. That's not good at all. Most matches that I go to in centers, it's the women who outdo the brothers in the participation. Most matches. Right. Hold up. Please, in brief.
So Ibn Sajid. So he was jealous of the Kaaba. And he was Ibn Sajid.
Masajid?
No, he built it
a church.
A church, something like that. And then someone pooped on it. I mean, something pooped on it. And then afterwards he got so jealous that he got an army, elephants and everything. And he was about to attack the Kaaba. And when he was trying to, birds and stones attacked everyone that wanted to go, and everyone that died. The only people that were alive were the person that was forced. And the elephants died and everything.
So the Arabs, they call it the year of the elephant. Abdurrahman.
Yes. Afwan, yes, sir.
Tell them we were asking about Abdurrahman. I didn't have a reader. Mubarak refused to read for me. Allahu Musta'an. He broke my heart. Khair, inshallah. They call it the year of the Al-An'am al-Fi'l. Khair. Very good. Jazakallah khair. So that's when Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he said he was 2 years before the year of the Al-An'am. Now, the next benefit for the warm brothers and sisters is what? When it comes to keeping track of time, keeping order of the events of the seerah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and after Rasul ﷺ, we have the following things, adawa, the following things. Number one is called what? Ma qabla al-bi'tha. Ma qabla al-bi'tha. Is that which is before, or afwan, even before that. We say that which is before the mawlid, before the Prophet ﷺ being born. That's one yardstick of gauging time. Then the next point on our calendar is ma qabla al-bi'tha. Is that which is before the revelation? Yeah, in between that and between him being born. Or one may say, the next step is ma ba'da al-bi'tha. That which is after the Prophet ﷺ being sent as a messenger. The next point that we have is what? Huh? Al-hijra. Right? From the bi'tha to the hijra. That's one space or gap of time. And then the last piece is ما بعد الهجرة حتى اليوم. That which is after the hijrah to today. So when we say the year of the elephant, what time period is that? 10 years after the Hijra? When is the year of the elephant? Between two time periods?
Qabl al-Mawlid.
Qabl al-Mawlid. And what? Khair, inshallah, moving on. Amen. Do some more research on it, inshallah. I only give you a small amount in your cup. The rest you have to fill up. Inshallah. Khair. Tafadhal, iqra.
He stayed with him the entire time of the Meccan period and also remained by his side during the migration to Medina. He witnessed all of the battles that the Muslims fought in the time of the Prophet, and on the day of Tabuk, he was the flag bearer. He also led the people in Hajj, and the Muslims gave him the nickname the Khalifa, the Messenger. His father also accepted Islam. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq narrated hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and many of his fellow companions narrated from him, such as Umar, Uthman, Ali, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, and others. He died in the 13th year of the Hijrah at the age of 63.
Tayyib, yani, what is from the virtues of this great companion? He made the Hijrah, he's with the Prophet ﷺ, he witnessed every single battle, he was the flag bearer, he narrated hadith from the Rasul, and companions narrated hadith from him, from the Rasul. These are all from the virtues and brief points of interest from his life. So when you study the companion, there are certain things we said which are standard, and there are certain things which in the next final thought are considered to be, yani, garnishing the meal, garnishing the plate. Did he narrate a hadith? How many hadith? Who narrated from him? All of these things, they show and improve his status. Khairan, inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made Hajj. He led the people in Hajj when the Prophet was in Medina. And he was given the nickname the Khalifa of the Rasul. His father also accepted Islam, and he died in the year 13 years after the Hijrah at the age of 63. Moving on. Tafadhal.
Umar ibn al-Khattab ibn Ibn Abdul Aziz al-Qurayshi al-Adawi, the commander of the commander of the faithful Abu Hafs al-Thabur. He was martyred in the 23rd year of the Hijrah, in the month of Dhul-Hijjah. The exact date of the birth of Umar is not known. The consensus of opinion, however, is that Umar was born at Mecca around 580 AD. He was younger than the Holy Prophet of Islam by about 10 years. He was known for being one of the most rapid enemies of the Muslims before faith entered his breast. It is said that the Muslims did not offer prayer in public until he became a Muslim.
Missing something. He was said to be very tall, well built, with wide shoulders and fair skin. It's not in the book? Yeah, bismillah.
He was said to be very tall, well-built, with the wide shoulders and fair skin. But when he became a vegetarian due to the great famine that he and the Muslims suffered from, he became